Hello, this is Dr. Farnaz Amoozegar, Clinical Assistant Professor at the University of Calgary. I'm also a neurologist at the Calgary Headache Assessment and Management Program with a subspecialty in headache and a special interest in SIH, or spontaneous intracranial hypotension. So today we're going to do a short video discussing what SIH is, some of the things that we can do in terms of treatment, as well as workup for SIH, and where you can access some resources. So SIH, or spontaneous intracranial hypotension, is a term that's used to describe a neurological condition with a set of symptoms due to a spinal CSF leak that is usually spontaneous. However, this can sometimes be due to minor trauma, or it can be because the underlying membrane where the CSF is held can be quite fragile in some patients. So CSF is cerebral spinal fluid, which is the fluid that circulates around the brain and spine. And overlying that is a membrane called the dura. And the dura is a thick membrane that protects the CSF. And sometimes what can happen is that a leak can occur within the dura, or a hole can occur within the dura, and then CSF can start to flow out, and that is what leads to the symptoms. Patients with SIH will usually have a headache, but they can also have other symptoms like dizziness, feeling off balance, having trouble hearing, for example, or having a sensation that they're underwater. And there can be many other symptoms as well. So SIH can sometimes be difficult to diagnose because it can actually look quite similar to other headaches like migraine or tension headache. However, there are some things that can be helpful clues for us to determine that the headache is indeed SIH. So SIH are headaches that are classically worse when a patient is upright, and they're generally better when a patient is laying down. And that's what we call orthostatic headache or a postural headache, because it changes with posture. Whereas patients that have migraine or tension headache, for example, typically won't have that same orthostatic or postural association. They may say that they feel better when they lay down, for example, but that's often because they're just resting and avoiding activity, which tends to occur with migraine headaches, and that the headaches can worsen with activity. But it's still not that typical postural or orthostatic change. The other thing is that patients with SIH can sometimes have headaches that occur later in the day. So often they're fine in the morning when they first wake up, but in the afternoon or evening, they start to have a headache. The other thing is that migraine headaches tend to be throbbing. They usually worsen with activity, and they're associated with light or sound sensitivity, as well as nausea or vomiting, which can happen with SIH headaches, but usually that's not as prominent as migraine headaches. And these symptoms can occur with other headaches as well, less commonly. But again, it's less common with SIH. So tension headaches, on the other hand, are usually milder headaches that affect both sides of the head, and they're like a band-like sensation around the head. Also, patients that typically have SIH start to have a headache that comes on over a number of days to weeks, and then it basically stays. It doesn't go away. It's a persistent headache typically. It may go away in the morning or when they lay down, but it's typically persistent. Whereas headaches like migraine or tension headache, usually there is a history preceding that, in that the patient has had previous episodes of that headache, and then over time it may have become more chronic in nature. But typically it's not a headache that just suddenly starts and then persists. So the first is that patients can try conservative measures. So first they can try, for example, to lay down as much as possible for the first few days when they have the symptoms, and drink lots of fluids, water, as well as caffeine can be helpful, and then see if that will help solve the problem. If it doesn't, then typically a scan of the brain is done. Usually an MRI is a better test than a CT scan, but if an MRI is not available, a CT scan is also still helpful. If an MRI is done, an MRI with contrast injection is the best form of a test to do, because it can show us signs of SIH that we would not normally see sometimes with a plain MRI or with a CT scan. But it's important to keep in mind that about 15 to 20% of patients can actually have a normal MRI of the brain, so it doesn't rule out the diagnosis of SIH, but if the findings are there, it certainly is helpful. If SIH remains the strongest possibility, despite a normal MRI, if the clinical symptoms fit, then a blood patch can be done if the patient is still having symptoms. Usually this is done in the lumbar area first, because at that point the site of the leak is not yet known. So a blood patch is a procedure whereby a patient's own blood is taken out of a vein and re-injected into the lumbar area, and that basically acts like a glue to seal over the leak. And if the patient benefits, that's great, they can just be watched and followed, but If there's persistent symptoms, the blood patch may need to be repeated several times. If that's not successful, then more imaging is required, and those images involve actually trying to determine the exact site of a leak. And these can be things like a specialized CT scan that looks at the spine, MRI scans that look at the spine, or other specialized tests. So if the leak is found at a specific site based on the testing that's done, then a directed blood patch can be done. What that means is that the blood patch can actually be done at the site where the suspicion is based on the CT or MRI scan or other type of scan that's done. And again, that can be done sometimes up to a few times if needed. If unfortunately after that the patient still does not have success in terms of improvement of their symptoms, then other things can be done. For example, a glue type procedure can be done at the site of the leak if the site of the leak is known, or potentially surgery if the patient has still not had success with the treatments previously. Unfortunately, sometimes despite doing all of these investigations, the site of the leak cannot be found. And in those cases, we can go on then to use potential medications to help with the symptoms. So some of the different medications that we might try would be medications that we may actually try in things like migraine headache, because there haven't been really any studies to look at specific medications for SIH in particular. There are no clinical trials or large research studies. So some of the medications we would use, for example, would be things like botulinum toxin injections that we might use in migraine headache, for example, or medications that come from other classes that we use in migraine for pain, such as antidepressant medications, blood pressure medications, or others. The first step for the patient is to speak with his or her family doctor to discuss the problem. And if there is suspicion that the headache is not a typical migraine or tension headache, then the patient can be referred to a neurologist for further assessment. Once the patient is seen by a neurologist, typically a workup is undertaken and appropriate treatment can be initiated. If the patient's case is particularly challenging, for example, in terms of diagnosis or management, then the neurologist, if they're not a headache specialist, can certainly consider referring the patient to a headache specialist. There are also websites that can be useful resources for patients, such as the one that you're on here, the Spinal CSF Leak Organization of Canada, as well as the American Spinal CSF Leak Foundation, and others as well. And that's essentially the points we wanted to cover today for the video. We hope that you found it helpful.